Outer space.
I'd love to live a long time.
But growing lifespans have enormous implications for your health and retirement. And it's been a week since the Islamophobia debate. What was that really all about? What did it say about our politicians? And where does the road ahead lead? At Issue tackles that one. For centuries, humans have been fascinated with the idea of discovering alien life. But if it exists, the odds of finding it are remote. The slightest chance lost somewhere in the vastness of space. Though today, NASA pointed humanity's eyes into the void, to a cluster of planets where it hopes to find exactly that, signs of life. Talk about a needle in a haystack. There are 200 billion stars in our galaxy alone, and the Milky Way spans 100,000 light years. But this new major discovery lies less than 40 light years away. It's an entire solar system with seven planets roughly the size of our own, some with temperatures we'd be able to live with. Ron Charles explains.
The artists' renditions depict worlds filled with possibilities. Seven Earth-sized planets closely orbiting a red dwarf star called TRAPPIST-1, itself not much bigger than Jupiter. But what it lacks in size, it makes up for in providing just enough heat for three of its planets to be Goldilocks. Not too hot, not too cold, potentially just right for life. The lead astronomer is most excited about one of those.
One of them, our measurement, is precise enough to strongly suggest a water-rich composition, which is very exciting because this is one of the planets in the habitable zone.
He first used a large telescope in Chile last spring to discover three planets orbiting TRAPPIST-1. That led astronomers to point telescopes all over the world and in space at the star located just 39 light years from Earth. They found the additional four planets using NASA's Spitzer Space Telescope, still operating 12 years after its original two-year mission.
With this discovery, we've made a giant accelerated leap forward in the search for habitable worlds and life on other worlds, potentially speaking.
It is that potential that has astronomers like York University's Adam Muzzin filled with anticipation. That and the unprecedented magnitude of discovering seven planets with so much potential in one solar system.
This may be one of the first places that we answer that question of, is there other life out there? This is the kind of system where we would expect to find other life.
But even though TRAPPIST-1 is relatively close to Earth, using our latest rocketry, it would still take over 800,000 years to get there. Ron Charles, CBC News, Toronto.
Today's discovery obviously caught the attention of this guy, Bob McDonald, host of CBC Radio's Quirks and Quarks on a beautiful night in Victoria. Well, Bob, as Ron said, 800,000 years just to get there. That's going to have to pack a lot just for the trip. What are scientists expected to do next?
Well, the next thing, Peter, is to try to get a picture of these planets, and we're going to do that thanks to some super telescopes that are coming online. I have some animations of the first one. It's called the James Webb Space Telescope. It's going to be launched next year. This thing is huge. It's much bigger than the Hubble Space Telescope. It's the size of a tennis court, and it'll actually be able to see these planets, see their atmospheres, and start to tell us what they're actually made of. And in addition to that, I also have some animation of some big telescopes being built on the ground. One of them is called the 30-meter telescope, largest in the world. Canada's involved in this. So these big telescopes will be able to look at these planets and tell us the composition of their atmospheres. Are they nice and friendly like ours with nitrogen and oxygen and carbon dioxide? Or are they poisonous, like with ammonia and hydrogen cyanide and terrible things like Jupiter? We can figure that out. Are there signs of life in the atmosphere? Water vapor, methane? These are the things that we need to find out to determine what the environments of those planets are really like. So that's really the next step.
Well, you know, we've heard about stars being discovered before. Why is this one such a big deal?
Well, there's two reasons, Peter. I mean, having seven planets around one star is great, and all of them the size of the Earth. But this is all part of our lifelong quest to find ourselves in space. And we started this quest by looking at stars like our sun, and we did find thousands of planets, but not too many of them are like us. here's a star that's totally different from our sun. It's small, it's a little dwarf, and it turns out there's lots of them out there. So the fact that this one has seven planets means that there's probably more planets than we even thought about. So the odds of finding one of these has just gone up by a huge factor. All we need to do now is find out if there's anybody out there living on one.
Now, you're not easily excitable. Are you excited about this?
It's pretty big, Peter. It's pretty nice to have a gold mine like this just fall in your lap. And 39 light years is really not that far astronomically. Yeah, we're not going to go there with our rockets, but there's a lot we can learn about them from here.
All right. Listen, Bob, thanks very much. As always, Bob McDonald in Victoria tonight. Well, on to other news now. Montreal's police department is reeling in the wake of another scandal. It comes after two former Montreal cops went public with a bombshell of a story. It involves allegations of criminal activity within the force and deliberate efforts to stop whistleblowers from going public. Allison Northcott has the details.
Former Montreal police officers Giovanni DeFeo and Jimmy Cacchione say they found evidence of corruption within the force and tried to report it in 2011.
We noticed that a few individuals were committing crimes, and we notified the director, the chief at the time, and nothing was moving then.
They continued to look into the alleged corruption. They won't say exactly what it was. Then DeFeo says he and Cacchione became the target of an internal affairs investigation and were suspended.
We believe it's a direct retaliation in the sense where a lot of people were more preoccupied about their image than preoccupied about where is the organization going.
They allege the investigation against them was based on fabricated evidence. Neither of them was ever charged, and disciplinary action against them was thrown out when they agreed to step down from their jobs in 2014.
Bonsoir. Bienvenue à Gire.
Their story came to light in a report on the French language network TVA last night. It prompted Montreal's police chief, who was not in charge at the time, to ask provincial police to look into it.
To make sure everything went right in those investigations and also validate all the new facts that we heard yesterday.
Montreal's mayor says he is equally troubled by the allegations.
If there's issues in some services, if there's kind of a culture, a bad culture in the way that you govern among themselves, we have to shed a light on it. And we have to not only react, but we need to inquire, and then we need to make sure that there's consequences attached to it.
The province's public security minister said he's satisfied with the police chief's quick response. But opposition leaders say it's not enough to have police investigate police.
It's important that the population of Quebec, that they trust 100% our police groups. So I think it's important to give this inquiry to an independent body.
Quebec does have an independent investigations bureau, but the government says it's not mandated to look at internal cases like this. This is the latest scandal for Montreal's police force. The Internal Affairs Unit also came under fire last fall for monitoring journalists, obtaining warrants to access their cell phone call logs as part of another investigation into their own officers.
The Montreal Police Union says the force's disciplinary process is suffering from a tragic lack of credibility. It's calling on the province to act to rebuild the trust of its members and the public. Allison Northcott, CBC News, Montreal.
CBC News has learned that the Canada Revenue Agency is implementing an extraordinary new measure as part of its crackdown on offshore tax evasion. The CRA is now recording the fingerprints of every person charged in Canada with tax evasion, a move that could restrict their foreign travel. The fingerprints will be accessible to Canadian police as well as some foreign agencies, including U.S. border officials, who may consider the individual inadmissible to their country. Prime Minister has announced four more federal by-elections to be held on April 3rd. Two are in Alberta in the ridings of Calgary Heritage and Calgary Midnapore. The two others, Markham Thornhill in Ontario and the riding of Saint-Laurent in Quebec. A fifth by-election on the same day in Ottawa-Vanier was called on Sunday. If you were overpaid because of the Phoenix pay system problems and are worried about filing your taxes, the department responsible says don't be. It says overpaid employees should file their taxes as usual. If they flagged an overpayment by the end of last year, their T4 will be correct. If they didn't, they should file the T4 they received, and an amended one will be sent by Phoenix to the Canada Revenue Agency. Almost 300 public service jobs are being eliminated in Newfoundland and Labrador. Premier Dwight Bull campaigned in 2015 on a promise to avoid job cuts. His government says the previous government wasn't honest about the province's finances and left it no choice but to eliminate the non-union management jobs. There are about 48,000 public sector jobs in the province. Coming up, migrants heading for Canada first have to get into Mexico. You'll hear firsthand about all the challenges. And is Islamophobia a defining issue for Canada's political parties? Andrew, Chantel, and Althea are just minutes away. After nearly a year of protest standoffs with police and a brief taste of victory against the Dakota Access Pipeline, the encampment at Standing Rock lies in ruins. Demonstrators scattered like ashes from the tents that today they set on fire. Police have made arrests, but as Cameron McIntosh explains, for some, the pipeline fight is not over.
For you guys. Standing Rock's last stand. A handful of protesters in a stare down with police enforcing a 2 p.m. eviction order. Others left peacefully as tents and teepees too heavy to pull through the muck burned, all the while asserting their right to be here.
It amounts to an ethnic cleansing. It's a place that Native nations have the internationally recognized right to be.
For several months, demonstrators here have opposed the Dakota Access Pipeline, partially owned by Calgary-based Enbridge. It runs under a nearby lake. The local Standing Rock tribe argues that threatens their drinking water and violates treaty rights. At its peak, there were thousands of people here. At times, it got violent, with demonstrators clashing against security and police as a complicated legal and political process played out. At one point, the pipeline was put on hold pending more environmental study.
The Dakota Access Pipeline.
Only to be greenlighted again a few days after Donald Trump took office. Around the same time, tribal leadership called for a change in tactics, saying the camp outlived its purpose.
Concerned about health and safety. It's just unfortunate that it has evolved to that.
The environmental protest also became an environmental concern itself. Authorities wanting to get this all cleared away before spring flooding. As the deadline drew near, most left peacefully. Some taking the state up on an offer of a free bus ticket. Others did dig in and resist, police reporting at least 9 arrests.
We knew this day was going to come. We knew that they need to remove themselves from this. And it's unfortunate that they put themselves in this situation.
In the meantime, construction on the pipeline has resumed. Oil could be moving through it in a matter of weeks. The Standing Rock tribe is still trying to get it shut down, shifting its focus to U.S. federal court. Cameron McIntosh, CBC News, Winnipeg.
Officially, anyway, the body in Kuala Lumpur's morgue has no known kin and no known cause of death. But today, Malaysian investigators gave details on what's believed to be the assassination of Kim Jong-nam, the exiled half-brother of North Korea's iron-fisted ruler.
These two ladies were trained to swap deceased face.
Investigators say two of the suspects trained in local malls to approach and apply an unknown toxin to their target before going through with the alleged attack in an airport last week. Afterwards, they cleaned their hands. Police also revealed the identity of more suspects, a North Korean airline employee and a high-ranking diplomat at the North Korean embassy. An infamous emblem of the suffering and oppression of the Dachau death camp has been returned. The iron gate bearing the words, "Work will set you free," was stolen from the camp back in 2014. After an anonymous tip, it was recovered in Norway. A newly released video shows movie star Harrison Ford's recent brush with aviation disaster. As an airliner with 110 people aboard was preparing to take off, Ford's small yellow plane streaked just overhead. Ford, a vintage plane enthusiast, was reportedly told to land on a runway, but instead sat down on a nearby taxiway. The U.S. Federal Aviation Administration is investigating the close call. As we reported last night, the life expectancy of Canadians is getting longer. but planning for the future can be overwhelming. We have two stories on this topic tonight. As Christine Birack reports, when it comes to life expectancy, Canada still lags behind other countries.
And hold.
Canadians are living longer, healthier lives, but Alan Rudolph is way ahead of the curve. He's 93.
No secrets. Just go on living and try to be as social and just enjoy doing what you're doing.
A British study looking at life expectancy by 2030 found among 35 developed countries, South Korean women are forecast to live the longest at nearly 91. South Korean men, 7 years less. Canadians go from 83 and 79 years old today to 87 and 84 for men. The U.S. is near the bottom of the list at 83 and nearly 80.
So South Korea, a country that is doing remarkably well, they have some of the lowest levels of hypertension and obesity in the world. They have had some of the best investments in childhood nutrition.
While living into our mid to late 80s is impressive, researchers say countries like Australia and Italy are surpassing Canada.
It's kind of a good news, bad news story. Canada, I kind of think of Canada as sort of a second class.
Researchers say that's largely the result of higher smoking and obesity rates. Access to health care pulls down the U.S., but the biggest overall driver of life expectancy is social inequality. Aboriginal people in this country see a lower life expectancy, in some cases, by as many as 10 years.
So if you think of inequalities or poverty, it's actually more important than, you know, our major disease killers.
As for quality of life, researchers expect Canadians will be healthier going into later life, which for policymakers plays a big role in determining retirement age, pensions, and social programs in the future. Christine Birack, CBC News, Toronto.
They're Canada's bright and shiny future, not necessarily thinking about retirement. So with news they'll likely live longer, they're excited, right?
I'd love to live a long time.
That is the good news, you have to if you're prepared for it.
The problem is, right now, according to experts, many Canadians aren't. Forget about 2030. One study points out about 47% of Canadians currently have no employer pension, and even fewer young people have employer pensions.
If you take a look at the state of affairs in Canada with housing prices where they are, student loan balances being higher than they've ever been, it's a real struggle for young Canadians to even think about retirement planning because they're so focused on the here and now.
And there's a lot to think about. Generally speaking, say you need about $50,000 a year to live comfortably in retirement. That means someone who's 60, factoring in inflation, would need to have put away about $1 million. That money would last about 20 years. But with life expectancy expected to push 84, that same person will have to save even more.
So the reality is a lot of people are going to have to accept the fact that we are going to have to start retiring later and having phased retirements. So now there's more competition for jobs because if more older Canadians are staying in the workforce longer.
According to Statistics Canada, that's already happening. The number of workers 55 years old and up is surging. Higher life expectancy typically coincides with rising health care costs too. As for the Canada Pension Plan, a gradual increase in contributions by some Canadians is already on the way.
By 2019, we're going to enhance the Canada Pension Plan by replacing 33% as opposed to 25% of earnings when Canadians retire.
The government says what it won't do is change the age of retirement from 65, but even that may not be enough if individual Canadians don't also save for their own retirement. Natalie Collada, CBC News, Toronto.
Well, get ready for At Issue. The panel digs into the politics of Islamophobia. Next. Hi there, Peter Mansbridge again. As you know, we're in a commercial break right now, so this isn't live, what I'm doing right now, but it is an opportunity to talk to you because we want to use these commercial breaks for a different reason in the days ahead. We want to be able to talk to you, answer some of your questions. We've had a number already of me coming in ever since we were putting the National on Facebook, And one of them, one of the constants has always been, what's my office look like? Now, I don't know why you really wanted to know that, but I'll give you an opportunity. This is it. It's kind of in transition now as I get ready to move on to other things later this year. This is the National Host Office. It's great. It's an opportunity to keep some of the things you build up over the years. This is one of my favorites here, this picture. It was given to me after 25 years of the National. Why is it one of my favorites? Because you can look at it and actually watch me grow old. That's what I said to them when I gave it to them. I said, gee, thanks a lot. It's really nice to see how quickly I grew old in that picture. But anyway, it's a nice memento, the different backgrounds, the different looks of the National over the years, but the constant has always been what we're most proud of, and that's the integrity of the broadcast itself and the journalists who work on it. All of them, both those you see on camera and those who you don't see, who work behind the camera, whether it's the camera operators, the director in the control room, all those people who put together the show every night, the writers, editors, etc. So anyway, this is a little glimpse of my office. It's a good size because we have meetings in here throughout the day, and the major lineup meeting of the evening happens in this room as well, where the senior editors get together. We discuss the order of the program that you're watching right now, what makes it onto the show, what doesn't make it onto the show. Anyway, we'll have the opportunity to take your questions live during the program, and it'll start in the next break coming up on the National. So I'll be in the studio all properly dressed with my tie on and everything at that point. But we hope you're enjoying this opportunity to do the National on Facebook, and also the opportunity for you to get your questions in. So don't be shy, send them along, and we'll try to answer as many as we can. It's time to get back to work. Talk to you soon. Last week it was the debate over Islamophobia that split the Canadian Parliament. This week it's more division over the security of the Canadian border as asylum seekers walk into Canada illegally. What's happening and what does it really mean? Chantel's in Montreal, Andrew is here in Toronto, and Althea joins us this week from Ottawa. All right, well, these issues aren't really the same, but there is a kind of a common thread to them. Why is this stuff so contentious right now and in the Parliament of Canada? Andrew.
Well, you start with a legitimate concern, which is Islamist terrorism. That's a real phenomenon. It's a real danger to this country. But a certain section of opinion has taken that and run with it to extend to what they would call a critique of Islam, which as often as not degenerates into wild statements about Muslims in general, and even as a critique of Islam, usually caricatures, or you cherry-pick some crazy imam somewhere in the world, and then you make that stand for Islam. And while that's been a factor for some time in our debates, you now have a conservative leadership race going on, in which a certain section of the number of the leadership candidates are paying court to that slice of opinion within the party. Add to that this motion that was in front of the Parliament, a similar motion, of course, the Conservatives had happily signed on for back in October, I think it was, of last year. But now, with the leadership race on, suddenly it became this unbearable assault on free speech, et cetera, which is simply factually untrue. There is no doubt there are people out there who would like to restrict speech, on particularly in this matter, to do with Islam, and that's to be guarded against, and I would oppose it. But this motion, which is all it is, does not restrict anybody's speech.
Chantel?
There is no doubt that there are also people out there who have a fear or prejudice of Muslims and who are not terribly into immigration, and there is increasingly no doubt that they are overrepresented within the voting membership of the Conservative Party, and that some candidates, at least, are catering to that section of the party in the hope of winning the leadership. I think if you took away the Conservative leadership campaign, we wouldn't have been having this incredibly strange debate about a motion in the House of Commons. Like, motions in parliaments in Canada, there are a dime a dozen. They come from private members. They range from the National Assembly not liking the New York Times or the Washington Post to Mother's Day statements. They do not have any legislative impact, and they put no obligation on the government. This week, we saw former cabinet ministers from the Harper era entertain the notion that this was a threat to free speech. Only leadership politics of the worst kind can account for that.
Althea, you're watching a lot of this close up, both on the leadership campaign trail, but also right there in the House of Commons. Is that read that Chantal's giving us that there's a lot of leadership politics at stake here?
I agree with that partly. I'm not actually convinced that if there was no leadership race happening, that the Conservatives would have changed their behavior on this motion, which is M103, which is, as everybody else has said, a non-binding motion that does not change our hate laws in this country or affect your charter rights. Because if you look back in the fall, actually, when the Parliament was asked for unanimous consent on a similar motion condemning Islamophobia, a handful of Conservative MPs actually yelled out no. And this was unprompted and unplanned. But the fact that the leadership's office, the interim leader, Rona Ambrose, has not, you know, perhaps communicated effectively to caucus as to, and I know this, some Conservative MPs are very upset with this, she has not laid out perhaps a reasoning for why the Conservative Party has decided to not support this motion, or given very good example. Basically, the Conservatives got outmaneuvered by the Liberals. This is crass politics completely. The Liberals are trying to squeeze the Conservatives and portray them as a racist party, and the Conservatives got outplayed.
Andrew, is there danger for the Liberals in playing this game and trying to push the Conservatives down the racist track?
Well, in danger for the country. There's no doubt that most of the fault here is on the Conservative side for taking the bait on this private member's motion. And having disgraced themselves on that, some of the more moderate members of the party were looking for a bridge to sort of get back to normalcy on this, and they provided a compromise motion, which is functionally, essentially identical to the original motion. If the Liberals were interested in making peace out of this, having made their point about the Conservatives, let's say, they could have then passed that motion. Instead, they voted against it. So both sides are playing politics, but I don't want to say that they're equivalent either.
Go ahead, Chantal.
To set up a trap, you have to find people who are dumb enough to walk into it.
That's right.
And why it sticks to the Conservatives, the federal Conservatives, and will stick to them, is that at the same time, some of their fellow travelers at Queen's Park, for instance, have absolutely no problem endorsing the same kind of resolution. So in the end, you're left with a rationale that basically says a party that repeatedly backs motions on anti-Semitism, for instance, and never tells you that means you can't criticize the state of Israel, is now trying to bridge that impossible ford and to say this is where this is going to. The danger to the country that Andrew is referring to is that one of Canada's strengths in the immigration debate, as opposed to other places, is that we have not had a party that has catered to fears about immigrants in the past. And the Liberals are pushing the Conservatives down that road for partisan gain, but in the end, everybody will lose.
Exactly. All right, let me just move it quickly to the security of the border issue, because another Conservative, Tony Clement, got kind of caught on this one in an interview with CBC Radio in Montreal this week. And, the interviewer was pressing hard to try and get the Conservative position on what they would do with these people who are walking across the border. Let me show you what happened.
The RCMP are there on the border. What would you like them to do differently?
I would like the government to come up with a plan to apply the law.
And now, my question is, what would that mean? Well, I'm curious to know what happens to those people who are crossing on foot when they meet the police.
I'm not the government. The CBC is not the government. It's up to the government.
With respect, you're the official opposition, and you're supposed to be coming up with solutions as well as just criticizing.
Come up with a plan.
You don't have any idea how it should work?
Sir, now you're putting words in my mouth.
Well, then tell us how it should work.
Sir,
I mean, it's a simple question.
We have a problem. It's simple. Apply the law.
Well, apply the law? Would they stop them? Would they say, I'm sorry, you can't cross here and you should go back across the border?
So Mike Finnerty, the CBC Montreal host, gets the dial tone. And, you know, in his defense, he just kept asking the same question over and over again, which is the way you can pursue these kind of interviews, but there was no answer forthcoming. Althea, you've had a chance to talk to Tony Clement. What happened there? Because it seems to underline the problem they've got on these two issues.
Well, I mean, I spoke to Mr. Clement today, and actually we're launching a podcast next week on HuffPost. It's called Follow Up. And he left the interview because he didn't like the question I was asking him. And then he came back and said, I'm not hanging up. And he took the microphone and he said, I'm not hanging up. Basically, he didn't have an answer because the government is following the law. Perhaps there are things that he could have suggested. Maybe he wants to suggest that the government change the law so that we detain new arrivals for a longer period of time. Right now, basically, they're arrested and they're let go if they, you know, are not a danger to the public or their identity can't be verified. Or we have concern that they're not going to show up at a hearing. In those cases, we can detain them. Maybe there's a, you know, there could be a suggestion that we change the law so we detain them right away. I don't know. But instead of offering some suggestions, he just kept saying the government should obey the law. Well, the government is obeying the law, and I think he just got frustrated because he didn't have anything else to say.
Chantal, how'd you see?
Well, because it's hard for the Conservatives to argue this. You should detain people for whatever amount of time they may have in mind when you're watching little kids and toddlers and babies crossing that border. The Conservatives obviously do not want to ask Trudeau to suspend the agreement that treats the United States as a safe haven, meaning if you show up at a proper border point from the U.S., you're going to be turned back because you are in a safe country. The Conservatives don't want to go down that road. For sure, nobody has come up with an answer, and for sure, when the weather gets warmer, as those anti-illegal immigrant statutes that President Trump has in mind come into force, there will be more people coming to the border, and some semblance of a solution will have to be found.
Andrew, help us wrap this discussion up, because both these issues have made headlines for a week. They could be, you know, one-week wonders in our business, or they could be one of those issues that defines a party for some time in the future. Where are we on those two on this?
Well, there's legitimate concerns in both cases. In one case, Islamist terrorism. In this case, you're talking about the rising numbers of people arriving illegally. The Conservatives have a checkered history on this. They made great strides under Stephen Harper in terms of reaching out to immigrant communities, particularly under Jason Kenney's tenure at Citizenship. And then they also made some missteps, things like the niqab ban, et cetera, that did not play well and shouldn't have played well, not only with immigrant communities, but I think with the broader population. There's no doubt, however, that there is a section of public opinion out there that, depending on how you press that nerve ending, will respond. We've seen this over and over, not just with the Conservatives, but with the PQ in Quebec, with the McGuinty government in Ontario. Sometimes it can work for you, discreditably, I would say, but sometimes it works. But sometimes, if you play it wrong, it can really backfire. And the Conservatives have to be very conscious, from a narrow partisan sense, that they could do themselves a lot of damage on this file in pursuit of short-term gain or in pursuit of satiating this one section of their base. To my mind, the only candidate, and this is not an endorsement because there's lots more issues to be decided on this, but the only candidate among the leaderships who's spoken out forcefully on this is Michael Chong. And I would say a lot of other leading members of the party need to start speaking out on this, need to start saying we cannot go down this road as a party.
All right. Going to leave it at that for this week. I'll see you. Thanks for joining us. Andrew here in Toronto, Chantal in Montreal. Well, if you're wondering where Rex is this week, he'll be by tomorrow in his regular Thursday night slot. And At Issue will be back on Thursday night next week. As for tonight, The National will be back in just a moment with this story.
The kids didn't know nothing about drinking out of the tap. You know, like when we first got it, they were all surprised.
For the first time in 14 years, an Ontario First Nation has reliable, clean running water. But is government policy setting them up to fail? Plus, on a dangerous trek to Canada, migrants must first get into Mexico. And hello, once again, Facebook Live fans. We are going to give you about 4 minutes of time here to answer many of your questions. Lots have come in during the At Issue panel, so we'll get to them while we're here going on in the studio. We're setting up for the next block. That was block two. Block three is a special segment that we have, and I'll have to change locations to get there. But you'll see all that happening while we get ready for it. Let's go to your questions. Katerina Mamula asks, Who's your favorite political figure, whether contemporary or historically? Churchill, Winston Churchill. I find his political life amazing, and wish I'd ever had the opportunity to interview him. Gene Jeffrey asks, how do you deal with difficult subject matters or difficult interviews? Same way you deal with easy ones. You have to prepare, be ready for any eventuality within that story, within that interview. So there's a lot of reading, there's a lot of preparation, there's a lot of discussion with those who are working on the program with you on those particular issues. Stefan Vera asks, what are you going to miss the most and what are your plans after the broadcast? The best thing about being a journalist is the stories often, especially in my role, the stories are changing every day. So every day you're learning new things and you're interviewing new people. It's just you never get bored. Even on slow days, things can be pretty exciting because you're always learning. Tiffany Johnson asks, what was your most harrowing or hardest newscast? I think most of us in this business would agree that the most difficult days, the harrowing days, are days where you're dealing, whether it's in the studio or in the field, with loss of life, especially among the most innocent that we have our children. And when you're dealing with those kind of stories, it is very difficult. Dave Dowling asks, what is your favorite moment from your years of interviews? I'd have to say being in the White House 3 or 4 weeks after the inauguration of Barack Obama and interviewing the 44th president of the United States. That was a pretty big deal when you realize kind of where you are and who you're talking to. But, you know, I've been lucky. In the time I've been around, I've probably done 15,000 plus interviews. So there are lots of special ones within that mold. That's certainly one of the most famous.
Okay, Peter, if you could get into position, please, big wall.
See, they're giving me a hard time already. Minute and a half until we're out of this commercial. I can take a couple more, but I have to change locations. We're going over to what we call the big wall. That gives you a sense of the story coming up. Next question. Dadir Hassan, Peter, you still look so young. What is the secret? Really? Makeup. John D. Hamilton asks, what is your vision for the CBC? What specific changes in the next 5 to 10 years to make it even more relevant for Canadians coast to coast to coast and around the globe? I have 50 seconds. I have a lot of strong feelings about that, but I'll sum it up this way. The CBC has to remain relevant to all those it serves. So the people of Canada have to make their voice known about what they want out of the National Public Broadcaster, and we have to be able to respond to that. Nolan David Dawes asks, did your journalism ever change how you live? Everybody's affected by what they see and where they've been. And as a journalist who's had the opportunity to travel the world and see a lot of things, some good, some awful, you're impacted by all of those things. Look, lots of terrific questions here. I can't get to all of them. We have to get ready to go to what we call block four. And we're going to do that right now.
When we first got it, they were all surprised, like, really? We're going to drink this?
Imagine being 12 years old and only then taking your very first sip of clean water from a tap in your home. It was a taste of victory that was a long time coming on the Pickmobert First Nation in Ontario. It was under a boil water advisory for more than a decade. Then, last year, a new water treatment plant got up and running. But residents' relief at finally having potable water is now being tempered by reality and the new challenge of keeping it clean. Margot McDermott has the story.
This is something we all take for granted, turning on the tap to make a meal. But Jessie Sabourin couldn't do this before. Even bathing her young children was risky.
When they were babies, we used the jug water. We'd warm up the jug water because we didn't really trust the tap water.
Last June, Jessie and her neighbors finally got safe drinking water. Cooking for the family is easier now, but her five kids are still getting used to it.
The kids didn't know nothing about drinking out of the tap. You know, like when we first got it, they were all surprised, like, really? We're going to drink this? And I'm like, yeah, it's good to drink.
Picmobert is a First Nations community of about 350 people in northern Ontario. It's had a boil water advisory on and off for more than a decade. There's no proper water treatment plant. Water was delivered in jugs.
How many of those would you get?
For a week, I think they'd give us four or five.
Then we'd run out. Then I gotta go borrow water.
Jesse's husband, Basil Sabourin, laughs about it now, but it was hard.
I feel relieved now that I don't have to struggle to get a jug of water or, you know, that's one thing that comes to my mind right now is relief.
There was relief, too, at the elementary school,
clear the water,
where an entire generation of kids was growing up wary of water from the tap.
It would be really tough to have a shower or a bath, because you don't know if the water's going to be clean or dirty. So it would be hard to wash your face.
When we used to take baths, the water would be really dirty, and now when we take it, it's really clear.
Students here have to drink bottled water for a while yet. The school's one drinking fountain is a casualty. Left dry for so long it rusted and has to be replaced. Principal Jackie Craig is grateful the hardest part is over.
There's an accomplishment in the air, but there's also a feeling of it's about time.
This is a pre-filter. Before that, there's actually a strainer.
It all changed with Picmobert's new $13 million water treatment plant. 7 years ago, the community pushed hard for this plant after E. coli was discovered in the lake that's the water supply.
This is a pretty state-of-the-art plant.
It's a stark contrast to the old pump house that Picmobert used for decades.
This is kind of archaic and really wouldn't be acceptable in this day and age.
People in these houses now have a shiny new water treatment plant, but the trick for this small community is to keep it going. Chief Wayne Sabourin is proud of the new treatment plant and of the changes it's brought to his community, but he's also worried. Ottawa funded the plant, but there's no extra money to operate it.
We got a beautiful plant, $13 million, but if I can't maintain it and operate it, I haven't got the funds, the plant's going to fail, and how do I fix the problem?
Dave Craig has seen that happen many times before.
A lot of places I worked in the north, the money wasn't there on time and that, and a lot of those plants went downhill pretty quick. So one of my goals is to make sure that doesn't happen in Picmobert First Nation.
So Craig is teaching people from the community to run the plant. Orville McWatch Jr. is one of the trainees, but even that could be temporary. The reserve can only pay McWatch just over minimum wage. Once he's learned the highly technical job, he could be lured away by a nearby town with more money.
Obviously, I want to stay. It's my community. I want to keep my family here. I want to live here, grow up here, eventually maybe retire here. But it's the wage that could possibly stop me from doing that.
It means Picmobert is facing uncertainty and a financial struggle to keep its clean water. Still, the chief thinks it's worth it.
To me, it's awesome. It's the greatest thing, you know. You get excited over simple things that were other Canadians always had, you know, and that's how we feel in the community, you know. We finally got something, you know.
Jesse Sabourin is just happy that life is a little easier and her kids can drink the water.
Not every community has that. And some communities are having harder time to get it than us, so I'm happy we were able to get it.
Happy about clean water from a tap, still very much a luxury here. Margaret McDermott, CBC News, on Picmobert First Nation.
A total of 71 First Nations across Canada are currently under long-term water advisories. Prime Minister Trudeau has promised to get clean tap water to all of them by 2021. And drinking water is the focus of another story we're working on.
I'm Stephen D'Souza in Flint, Michigan. The water crisis here may have passed from the national headlines, but it's still very much the reality for people who live here,
especially the 5,000 children who are exposed to lead.
I get really emotional about it.
because I have no idea the effects it will have.
A research center.
We'll show you what the city of Flint is doing to combat the lead poisoning of its most vulnerable citizens next week on The National.
Well, right now, get set for a trip to Mexico's southern border. Asylum seekers risk everything to get there, only to find more hurdles. That's next on The National. Time to look at the day's business numbers. The TSX dropped 92 points. The dollar fell slightly. In New York, the Dow hit another record high, but the price of oil closed down 74 cents a barrel.
This is the story of building the Trans Mountain Pipeline. Between Jasper and Red Pass, a start is made. All the latest weapons employed by engineers in modern pipeline construction converge on the theaters of war. The enemy, one by one, toppling to echoing cries of timber. And the steel monsters arrive. To 140 sidings from Edmonton to Vancouver, 5,000 railway flat cars bring their loads of pipes, and then to their individual prearranged spots in the continuous chain. They're linked together by a complicated process that assures 100% accuracy. The pipe is 24 inches in diameter, and every inch of it must be evenly coated, and then checked and rechecked. Then a wrapping is added, made from glass, felt, and asbestos, as the men observe their finished product laid to rest. A continuous tube. Liquid railway, stretching 718 miles.
The big question is, of course, whether there is life on Mars, and the short answer is that it's not impossible.
No one knows what Mars really looks like, but this week, streaming back from deep space is the best information in history, bringing us nearer the answers concerning the origin of life, whether man is something special or a special freak.
The search for life on Mars is still continuing. Data received from the Viking landers have puzzled NASA scientists, and within the past 2 days, they've been able to confirm that the ice caps of Mars are really frozen water, not carbon dioxide as once believed. So the chances of finding life get better with each passing day.
Its past was hostile and torn by meteors. Its present is cold and barren. A colony here would seem a futile fantasy. But today's dreamers are scientists, and they do their dreaming for NASA.
I think the possibility of Mars as a second home for mankind is very important for our future as a race.
The students are building a prototype Martian colony called Marsville. It's on Earth, but they do understand what it will take to settle on Mars.
The temperature on Mars is a lot colder than on Earth.
And these students understand cooperation is the only way to get to Mars.
With all of the technology they have now, we could have somebody go up pretty soon.
They've come from all over the world for this meeting of the International Mars Society. They've got bumper stickers. They've got a Martian flag already picked out.
The one question that always comes up is this. Is it worth the many billions more to put people on the surface of the red planet rather than just machines?
The Mars fans here admit the barriers are huge, but they also say we have the capability and the money to get to Mars. All we need now is the will to do it.
To find out more, we need to go out into space, and space research, like politics, is the art of the possible. What we would like to do must be weighed against what we can do.
What happens at Hinchinbrook Farm is not really conventional therapy.
I know he's in there.
It's time to stop putting these people away, out of sight, out of mind.
Free Reigns, Thursday at 9 on First Hand.
If anyone wants to hurt you, because you're just a foreigner, and it's very easy.
Last night, we showed you Somali migrants stuck in Mexico, anxious to reach Canada but afraid to cross into the U.S. Tonight, we go further south to Mexico's border with Guatemala. That part of their journey to asylum has its own challenges. Now, one note of explanation, we are hiding the faces of some of these people. Here's Evan Dyer at the border of desperation.
The town of Tapachula, Chiapas, just north of Mexico's border with Guatemala, is seeing a new kind of migrant with different origins and increasingly different destinations. It's full of people who don't speak the language, like this group of Haitians living in a string of shacks just off a major avenue and who aren't going to the United States.
Canada? Canada.
Canada.
Si.
Day breaks over the Suchiate River. For most African and Asian migrants, this will be the ninth American border they cross on their journey north. The rafts are made of inner tubes of tractor tires.
Right now we're crossing the border between Guatemala and Mexico across the Suchiate River. On this side, Guatemala. On the other side, Mexico. This is a critical crossing for Africans on the way to Canada. Locals pay a dollar, Africans pay about 10 times that.
Angel is Guatemalan, like most of the raftsmen here. He says the migrants are leaving behind a dangerous country.
What you see in Guatemala is extortionists, rapists, thieves, and kidnappers. Why? Because the government does nothing to stop them. If they kill someone, it's like, oh well, he's dead. Probably had it coming.
Indeed, Central America is the most dangerous part of the migrants' route north. At the gateway to the isthmus, the Darien Gap between Colombia and Panama, a roadless jungle of mountains and rivers. Many of the migrants still bear scars from that crossing.
We got three mountains and a river. We've been walking through river almost 5 days inside the river. River, mountain, river, mountain.
Qatar is one of a group of Somalis who've reached Tapachula. With him, 20-year-old Abdi Samad.
I saw my eyes for dead body. Really, yes, dead bodies. Really, I was shocked because there's no any food, there's no place any to sleep, and river and mountain.
But the worst country to cross, the migrants all agree, is Nicaragua. The socialist Sandinista government pursues them relentlessly, and Nicaraguan police collude with smugglers and bandits to strip migrants of their possessions, like Rahma, who says she fled Somalia after her husband was murdered.
In Nicaragua?
Yeah.
What happened there?
They take my clothes, my cell phone, money.
Half the migrants we met were robbed in Nicaragua. By the time they reach this detention center in southern Mexico, they've also passed through Honduras, the country with the highest murder rate on the planet.
Even the Africans who make it across safely usually hand themselves in, and many of them end up spending weeks here at the 21st Century Detention Center, one of the largest migrant detention centers anywhere in Latin America. And protests like the one we're seeing right now happen here all the time.
At the front gate, we find a mixed group of Bangladeshi and Nepalese migrants waiting to turn themselves in. It's the only way to get papers that will allow them to cross Mexico legally. Simanto Das is from Bangladesh's Hindu minority and says his family sent him abroad to escape Islamic extremists targeting Hindus in his district.
My father little bit give me money, maybe $4,000 gonna give me cost.
It's quiet today at the center. On some days, it can look like this. Qatar's group have already been released from detention and given 20-day visas to transit Mexico. But 6 days are already gone, and they haven't moved north. The arrival of President Trump has thrown a wrench in their plans.
There's a lot of horrible things happening there in Somalia. That's why I left in Somalia, and I'm going to Canada, and I'm stuck here in Mexico.
For now, they're guests of Concepcion Gonzalez, a Mexican woman known affectionately by the migrants as Mama Africa. Along the road are immigration checkpoints where Mexican officials detain migrants like these Guatemalans as part of an agreement with the United States, an agreement that Mexico is now threatening to scrap. Mama Africa warns her guests there are other dangers on the road too.
I always tell them, buy your food, eat, and get right back on the bus. Don't go wandering around, because a lot of people believe they have lots of money on them, but I live with them. I know it isn't true.
For now, though, these migrants remain stuck in Chiapas, Mexico's poorest state, trying to keep a low profile while the days on their visas count down. Canada is still a long way away. Evan Dyer, CBC News, Tapachula, Mexico.
Up next, danger at the bottom of the planet. Something enormous is in the works.
I'm Anna Maria Tremonti. Tomorrow on The Current, biochemist Sylvia Tara is on a mission to educate us on the complex role that fat plays in the body. The Secret Life of Fat on The Current, weekday mornings at 8:30 on CBC Radio 1.
This afternoon in St. John's, Newfoundland, a young man named Terry Fox started running.
Many people have run or walked across Canada, but Fox hopes to be the first to do it with an artificial leg.
I got a lot of positive attitude and I think I can do it.
He calls his running style the Foxtrot. After 25 days in Newfoundland, Terry had raised $25,000.
That song was commissioned by the Cancer Society, which had its own doubts when he started off. Now, as he pounds out the kilometers, the money pours in, most of it in cash.
He's got all the guts in the world. And I wish him all the luck in the world, too. And I hope he makes it.
What do you think of Terry Fox?
I think he's great.
He'll make it. He'll make it.
The run to City Hall, down University Avenue, took Terry by hundreds of people. It was an emotional moment for many of them.
I knew I was going to make 20 miles. When people were out there like that, it was incredible. Today.
We've seen him surrounded by crowds of supporters, but the crowds go home. Terry keeps running.
I'm stubborn and competitive, and I don't know, I really enjoy life. I enjoy challenges. I don't like people feeling sorry for me. I don't like pity, and I wanted to show these other people what I could do.
The National with Norton Nash.
Good evening. A story of incredible courage came to an end today. At a news conference.
Yesterday I was running. And I had noticed a little bit of hardness in breathing. And I decided I had to go see the doctor. And it was discovered then that the cancer had spread. And now I've got cancer in my lungs. And
from one end of the country to the other, there has been a spontaneous outpouring of support for Terry Fox and cancer research. Rarely, if ever, have so many people been so deeply moved by one individual.
If it comes to the point where I'm told I'm going to die of cancer, I haven't got a chance, I've got to be able to face that. And
good evening. Terry Fox died this morning in a British Columbia hospital, 1 month before his 23rd birthday.
Well, he was a very brave boy, I must say, and I feel very, very sad about it.
Don't cry, love. It's all right. Don't cry, sweetie. It's all right.
I think he touched the hearts of a lot of Canadians, and they all really look up to him.
More than our sympathy, we would like you to express as well our profound gratitude for the gift which Terry gave to all of us, the gift of his own boundless courage and hope.
Canadians everywhere walked and jogged and ran to raise money for the fight against cancer.
He accomplished more in a few short months than most of us can hope for in a lifetime.
Monday, the search for Jesse continues.
Take me through step by step.
We were helping.
As a ghost from the past.
He's back.
Haunts Annie.
I'm pretty sure he watches me.
Bellevue, Monday at 9 on CBC.
You're looking at new aerial images of a huge crack in Antarctica, stretching 175 kilometers. It could break apart at any moment, creating one of the largest icebergs ever recorded. Researchers usually set up camp on the ice shelf, but this season, they're keeping their distance. That's the National this Wednesday night. For news at any hour, you can always go to our website, cbcnews.ca. I'm Peter Mansbridge. Thanks for watching.